Good morning, everyone. You are so welcome to our service of worship here on the first Sunday after Trinity. We're really excited to have our Soma team with us. They are on their way from Dollingstown, and they will be with us shortly as we celebrate time with them, as we celebrate all that has gone on over the weekend, and as we encounter a little more of the sweetness of God. I think some people maybe got a wee bag of honeycomb as they came in today. They might have got a wee bit of something to eat on later on during the sermon. But as we come before the Lord, we come with hearts open to him, hearts ready to hear from him, and hearts ready to praise. I'll ask you to stand with me as we look to the screen or to our service sheets as we begin our time of worship in some prayer. Let's stand. These words from Revelation chapter 3. The Lord says, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in. Give praise to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Tell of all his mighty acts and make his praises heard. Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Let all the people say, Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord indeed. And we'll do that now in song as we continue in worship with our first hymn, Be Thou My Vision, and then Jesus Be the Center. Let's sing.
Yeah.
Please do take your seats for a moment. Just a few announcements for today and the week ahead. We had a fabulous day yesterday out in Magheralin and out in Dallingstown, knocking on doors and speaking to people and praying for people. Such a fabulous day, and we're continuing that theme of sweetness and amazing grace. How sweet the sound throughout the rest of the weekend. So please do come along tonight here at 6:30. The service will be live streamed too for those that would love to come but are unable to, or if you want to send the link on to somebody in a distant land that you think would really enjoy tonight. We have a service of hymns of praise and stories of hope, all based around the anniversary, the 150th anniversary of Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace, written by John Newton all those years ago. And we'll hear a little bit of his story and hear hymns that speak of the amazing grace and the sweetness of the goodness of God. So that's tonight here at 6:30 here in Magheralin. And then tomorrow evening, there's another opportunity to spend time with our Soma team. We're meeting for a time of prayer here in the church tomorrow night at 7:30. And it's just a really beautiful opportunity to share with one another and pray and spend time with our Soma team, who you'll meet a little bit later on, who are diverse from different places in the world and who bring such a beautiful ministry to us here in Magheralin. And then on Tuesday morning, we have our coffee morning in the lounge in St. Saviour's from 10:30. Again, the Soma team sharing of ministries abroad will be there to share. So do come along for a time of fellowship and of chat. Lots of opportunities to spend time in prayer and in praise. If you're feeling like you want to be a wee bit more active on Tuesday night and you're a lady and you didn't come snow tubing last week, and we have something that's a little bit less adrenaline inducing, but still fabulous all the same. We're meeting at Hillsborough Forest Park and we're meeting in the car park. I'm looking at my wee sheet. We're meeting in the car park, Forest Car Park at Hillsborough at 7:30 on Tuesday night. And that is just a fab time, just a fun and laughter and a wee bit of exercise, which is good for us all. So please do come along if you are able. We're going to turn now to the Lord, and we're going to turn to the Lord actually now in prayer. I'm going to send Jamie up the left here with his plans, but we're going to turn to him in prayer now. As we reflect on a Psalm 18 specifically, and ask for the goodness of God, who is our rock and our fortress, to endure with us. So let's pray to him now. Let's pray. Some words from the beginning of Psalm 18. I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. My God, my rock in whom I take refuge. My shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call to the Lord. He is worthy to be praised. So I shall be saved from every kind of trouble. Father God, we thank you that you are our rock, our strength, and our fortress. Lord, we thank you that you are the only rock, the only foundation worthy of building our lives upon. Lord, we thank you that it is to the rock that is our Father God that we can cling. When the waters rage around us, we can cling safely to the rock who is our Lord, our fortress, and our deliverer. And as we continue in our service today, and as we consider the sweetness of God, and the sweetness of the honey that flowed from the rock, we pray, Lord, that we would know the sweetness of your goodness. in our own hearts, in the hearts of our family of faith here in Magheralin and in Dollingstown, Lord, and our church community. Lord, that we would take that goodness, the sweetness that we know into our home lives, into our families, into our working lives, into all the places we venture during the week, Lord. Would we be those that tell of the goodness of God's sweet mercy and amazing grace. And Lord, we pray that this morning our children and our young people would know that goodness. As many consider options after exams, as many prepare to move school in September, for parents who naturally are worried about their little ones and their young people, we pray that your goodness would be known in all they think and do and say. And bless them in this time of transition and in all the challenges they face that we as adults couldn't understand because they are so different from when we were growing up. Lord, bless them and keep them. Father, we call to mind all those today who are sick or ill, at home, in hospital, in residential care. Lord, we pray that they would know a touch of your comfort, and the sweet consolation of the God who is always with them. Lord, we think of those amongst our own church family who have been bereaved in recent days and weeks. We pray that your love would flow upon them, that your mercy and your goodness would give them strength for the days to come. And Lord, we pray as a family of faith that with our lips and with our lives, we would tell of the glory and the majesty and the goodness and the love of our Father who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we pray these things in his Son's name. Amen. And we, as a family of faith, continue in prayer with the family prayer that our Saviour himself taught us, saying, Our Father. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. 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 We're going to stand now to profess our faith, to affirm what we believe in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I'll ask you to stand with me. We turn to the screen and to our service sheets, and we say together, I believe in God. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. And before we turn to the Lord again in song in There Is a Higher Throne, I'm going to ask Cosman to come and bring us our Bible reading. Let's sit.
Our Bible reading this morning is taken from Psalm 81. Sing for joy to God our strength. Shout aloud to the God of Jacob. Begin the music, strike the tambourine, play the melodious harp and lyre. Sound the ram's horn at the new moon. And when the moon is full on the day of the feast, this is a decree for Israel, an ordinance of the God of Jacob. He established it as a statue for Joseph when he went out against Egypt, where we heard a language we did not understand. He says, I remove the burden from their shoulders. Their hands were set free from the basket. In your distress, you called and I rescued you. I answered you out of a thundercloud. I tested you at the waters of Meribah. Hear, O my people, and I will warn you. If you would but listen to me, O Israel, you shall have no foreign god among you. You shall not bow down to an alien god. I am the Lord your God, who brought you up out of Egypt. Open wide your mouth, and I will fill it. But my people would not listen to me. Israel will not submit to me. So I gave them over to their stubborn hearts, to follow their own devices. If my people would but listen to me, if Israel would follow me, my ways, how quickly would I subdue their enemies and turn my hand against their foes? Those who hate the Lord will cringe before him, and their punishment would last forever. But you would be fed with the finest of wheat, with honey from the rock. I would satisfy you. This is the word of the Lord.
Let's stand to sing now as we lift our voices in worship and in praise, singing There Is a Higher Throne. please do take your seats as we welcome both Matthew and Brittany. And I'll hand over to Matthew now. I think there is a handheld microphone there, Simon.
Oh, thank you. Well, good morning. I'm terribly sorry I'm so late. We were having such a wonderful time up the road. So I'm Matthew. You can tell what my job is. Sorry, I'm still letting go of this last service. It's really quite hard. So there are four of us amongst 60 people from all around the world, Australia, South Africa, the States. And we've come with a little mission society called SOMA. SOMA is sharing of ministry abroad. But SOMA in the Greek means flesh, body. So we are the SOMA of Christ. And our little mission society since 1978 has been called to bring encouragement around the world. And for the first 30 years it was really, let's re-begin our work in the Spirit. Let's rediscover who the Spirit to us. And my work is usually in Africa, where it's now going to the difficult places like Sudan or the Congo. And it's more being alongside people who know huge suffering and bringing the warmth of the presence of Jesus and a kind of indwelling hope and indwelling forgiveness. And it's extraordinary. I went to Goma, which has got a big volcano, you may have heard of it. And it's hard to get there. And there's always a couple of guys with Kalashnikovs keeping me safe. Can you believe it? And all I needed to do was walk into a church about this size, but with people sitting, standing, sitting on the floor. All I needed to do was walk in. That was the sermon. That was the prayer ministry. That was everything. Because it was saying, you're not forgotten. And the Lord hasn't forgotten. There is a good shepherd. There is another way. And if you live vulnerably, you can be very, very forlorn. And just, I remember at the beginning of the conference, the Lord gave me the 23rd Psalm. It took me an hour and a half. That's partly because I hadn't prepared it. It was the Holy Spirit sermon. It was also because it was being translated, so it took me 45 minutes. And what they all said afterwards was, there's no good shepherd in our country. There's just militia and corruption and not enough electricity. And where do we get fresh water from? Just stuff. But God said it should not be like this. So that's kind of where I come from, and an extraordinary, strange work I do when I'm in Africa. And then the Lord said, come to Northern Ireland. Now, you see, I'm married to Scott, and all our holidays are in Scotland. So this is a real cheat and an escape. It's a joy to be here. So there's four of us. The perfect moment. Just come and stand here. You don't have to say anything. We're all watching, yes, we're all watching. So that's me. Oh, I live in Hampshire, near Winchester, and I'm supposed to be retired, but it ain't going to happen. Here's Brittany, who is at seminary, Bible College, Theological College. She's going to be a vicar. Yes. She's appalled, but we're thrilled to bits. Here's Diane, who's a vicar. Working.
Not coloured because it's too hot.
I know And she and her husband, they're both priests, so they work together in a parish in the flat part of Yorkshire, near York. And this is Siri, who comes from Seattle. I've been practicing saying that. Who's a nurse. We'd call her a midwife. And now she works in oncology. And we are basking in being in the body of Christ, because we've not met before, and we are journeying so intimately and profoundly. And we will carry more of the Lord with us because we've been together. And that sheer joy. Hallelujah. Thank you. So, let me pray for you.
Want me to come down?
Oh, I always come up to you. No, I like looking up to you. Our Lord, here's our sister, your servant. And she has an amazing journey with you, amazing to us. And so we invite you, Lord Jesus, to draw us into her journey and to see you as she sees you and to surprise her as she looks to you. So come, Holy Spirit, and make complete what Brittany offers and make complete what each of us hears for your kingdom's sake, for Jesus' sake. Amen. The Lord be with you.
Thank you. This wasn't the plan to speak from up here, but at the beginning of the last service, the kids came up and they sang everyone's favorite child song, "This Little Light of Mine, I'm Gonna Let It Shine." Won't stick it under a bushel, no, I'm gonna let it shine. And I thought, oh gosh, I don't want to stand up there. That looks intimidating. I was looking down on everyone, and the Lord said, you get up there. So here I am. And hopefully his light will shine, and everyone will look around the pillars and see me. Praise be to God. So I'm certain that the scripture has already been read over you this morning, but the way that I work through the passage, I know I'm in one ear, out the other, too quickly. So I'll be reading through the passage and sharing what the Lord has been speaking to me through the passage, and pray that he will speak to you and to your hearts as I share what he's been speaking to me this morning. I'll also say I heard this fantastic thing that these congregations here together under Simon did yesterday, which was handing out honeycomb to strangers at doors. And when we were riding in the car from Glencraig, where we were before this, Richard was talking about this, and I thought, that's interesting. Because when I started praying about coming to Ireland, the Lord was talking to me about sweetness. And while we were at Glencraig, I started thinking about this very beautiful but slightly bizarre psalm that ends with this picture of honey coming from a rock. I mentioned it to Matthew, and he said, that's it. That's for Sunday. And so I know the Lord has already been speaking to you about his sweetness and commissioning you to carry that sweetness to the community here. So I pray this will add to the tapestry that he's already been weaving today. Sing aloud to God our strength. Shout for joy to the God of Jacob. Raise a song, sound the tambourine, the sweet lyre with the harp. Blow the trumpet at the new moon, at the full moon on our feast day. For it is a statute for Israel, a rule of the God of Jacob. He made it a decree in Joseph when he went out over the land of Egypt. I hear a language that I had not known. I relieved your shoulder of the burden. Your hands were freed from the basket. In distress you called and I delivered you. I answered you in the secret place of thunder. I tested you at the waters of Meribah. Now we can read this psalm, and if you know your Bible stories, you're probably thinking already, back to Exodus, when God delivered the people of Israel from slavery in Egypt. And what came next? They were in the wilderness, and they faced hunger and thirst, and God met them in that place. The first place they came to was a spring, but the water was bitter, and they couldn't drink it. So what happened? Meribah is the second name for the word Mara, which means bitter. And it is the place of bitter waters where they were tested that the psalmist is hearkening back to in this reference. They were thirsty. They needed to drink, but the water was bitter until God showed Moses a tree or a log or a branch depending on how you translate the Hebrew word eitz, which simply means something made from wood. And we, in our translation to English, get the sense from the context of the sentence. Now, this word is an interesting word because it comes up in key places in the Old Testament. And another place where eitz is used that is important in the story of who God's people are is when Abraham and Isaac went to the top of Mount Moriah, where Abraham was going to sacrifice his only son. He gave to Isaac the eitz to put on his back, and Isaac carried the eitz up the mountain of Moriah. That is a picture that's pretty clear for us, pointing to the cross, because it was Jesus, God's son, who received the eitz, the wood of the cross, and carried it on his back up the mountain, where he was our perfect atonement and sacrifice. So Moses was shown an eitz and put it into the waters of Marah, the bitter waters, while the people were thirsty. And we have to remember, they were in the wilderness, in the desert. Yeah, they'd seen God do all these amazing things, but have you ever been there? God's just done something amazing, but now there's another problem? You thought life's problems were solved. And now there's something more, and you're saying, well, unless you do something, God, I'm going to die of thirst. That's where these people are at. And Moses takes an eitz, puts it into the water, and it becomes sweet. And the people drink, and their thirst is satisfied. Friends, that's the wood of the cross that enters into our bitter circumstances of life. And we're met with God's provision of sweetness. So Psalm 81 begins with this: grab the tambourine and blow the trumpet, strum the lyre, sing praises to God, because this is what he has done for you, O people of Israel. He provided a perfect sacrifice. And for us, that's looking back to the cross, to the perfect sacrifice of Christ, where those things that the enemy has meant for our harm, sin, death, his own attacks, have been transformed by the power of the cross into sweetness. Paul says we are more than conquerors now in Christ Jesus. But the psalm continues. Hear, O my people, while I admonish you. We were just praising him for what he's done. O Israel, if you would but listen to me, there shall be no strange God among you. You shall not bow down to a foreign god. I am the Lord your God, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. Open your mouth wide, and I will fill it. This is more than looking back on the God who once did these things and depending on those past events. Exodus is not a book about God's miraculous works. It is about his name. At the beginning, when Moses sees him in the burning bush, he reveals his name to Moses. He is revealing his name to the Israelites as he conquers each of the powers and principalities that were coming against the Hebrew people so that they might be free to do what? To worship him, his name in the wilderness. Christ was made known to us through the cross. God was revealed to us through that sacrifice. It's not that we've been forgiven once and now we have the tools and the equipping to just apply that and keep moving on. It's not as though God forgave you once when you turned to him as a child, as an adult, whatever your story is. And now you just keep moving on. God's dealt with that. I look back at that and say, thank you, Lord. No. We still need him. We need his name in us, alive in us, a work with us. We don't come with one doctrinal understanding and apply it to our life's problems. We come to him and we open our mouths. There is something for you today in the particular moment that you're in now. Yes, because of what Christ has done, but now open your mouth and God will satisfy you. He will give you a fresh word for today. a fresh grace for this morning. But my people did not listen to my voice. Israel would not submit to me, so I gave them over to their stubborn hearts to follow their own counsels. Oh, that my people would listen to me, that Israel would walk in my ways. When we find we've wandered a little bit away, that we've trusted, yes, in Jesus, but then begun to do things by our own strength again, when we've grabbed a few tools for understanding the Bible or working in the power of the Spirit for ministry and said, oh, that's what I need now, I'll go on, and realize, no, I'm still hungry. I'm still thirsty. I still need the presence of God. I still need to call on his name, and we turn to him. His heart is for us. He's not standing in impatience, tapping his foot. No, he is looking to us with longing and love. Just turn back to me again. And I would subdue their enemies and turn my hand against their foes. Those who hate the Lord would cringe toward him, and their fate would last forever. It's not us who stand against the circumstances of life, against the enemy. It is Christ who stands for us. And we turn to him, and he defends us. But he would feed you with the finest of wheat. And with honey from the rock, I would satisfy you. So sometimes we come to the Lord and we say, right, I need you to provide for this circumstance, and I'd like X, Y, and Z, and please do it. Moses, when he was with the people in the wilderness wanderings, we know in one of the other stories of God's provision of water, he brought water from a rock, didn't he? Paul looks at that passage and says, the rock was Christ, from which the people drank and were satisfied. But here we have not just a rock with water, not just wheat, but the fat of wheat, the finest of wheat, and honey from a rock. I brought this passage into my Hebrew class because I thought, there must be something with this. It's so weird. You don't get honey from a rock. Maybe that's a weird Hebrew word for, you know, honeycomb or something. No, it just means rock. It's just as strange. And as I dug deeper, it's because I began to realize God has more for us than we can comprehend. He has more for us than we can understand. He works in wonderful, mysterious ways. How many of you, walking with Jesus your life, have seen him surprise you as you come back to him? I'm surprised by him all the time. If I ever stop being surprised by him, that's when I know I'm in trouble. Because God is higher than our thoughts. His ways are above our ways. There's always more and better with him. No matter what he's done for you in the past, we praise him for the work of the cross, which he refreshes in a new word today. And when we come to him now, we can come with expectation that there is more and better for us as we continue with him into the future. So this morning, as we have time of worship, there might be a circumstance in your life that feels impossible, or maybe you're actually quite content with the Lord. But come to him seeking the honey from the rock, that which is sweet of his presence, that which might be surprising to you, that which will do more than just satisfy your thirst and meet your need, but bring you to an experience of him that is deeper, that you might know him and call him by name and have an increasing fellowship with him this morning. So I believe Matthew is going to come up and lead us in a moment of quiet confession as we meditate on honey from the rock. And you may choose during that time to assist your meditations by looking at this rock that Siri found in our neighbor's yard and that Diane poured honey over this morning. There we are. Yeah, careful, Matthew. You never know what's going to happen when the Holy Spirit's in charge. But meditate on the sweetness of God as Matthew leaves us in a confessional and meditative space now.
Diane has an exuberant approach to pouring honey over rock. Here she comes. Yeah, absolutely. You're not obliged to empty it.
It's okay, there is a tray.
I know you've had a liturgical confession, but I think we've got three responses to what Brittany has brought us. And one's a very simple confession, and one's an invitation to touch the stone, and another one is to invite us to pray for you. Lord, thank you for Brittany. I've heard two different sermons this morning. Well, kind of different. Thank you for her anointing, and restore to her, we pray, what she's given. And protect her from the enemy who likes to kick back. Come, Lord Jesus, your shadow over her. Amen. There's a very simple confession which uses the Kyries. So I say, Lord, have mercy. You say, Lord, have mercy. I say, Christ, have mercy. You say, Christ, have mercy. And then one more, Lord, have mercy. And then I'll take you through a song, not singing. And then the invitation would be, if you'd like to walk forward and touch the stone. And you may like to touch the honey. Simon said, dip and lick, don't lick and dip. And as Siri, the nurse, says, honey is an antibacterial, antiviral substance. That's why we use it to keep things safe. So we reflect a little bit on the psalm. The children of Israel were learning. They'd been in slavery for 400 years. They were learning what it was to be society again. A people again. They'd been living in a desert country with the river running through, and they were learning to live again with the river of life running through. Yahweh had been beyond reach. And that's us. Sometimes we feel life's a desert and we need to return. When we were at the other church, I was reminded, I've often said over the years, that when we make a confession, the most important part's the absolution. And the hardest part is receiving the forgiveness, or can be. And that's, you know, Jesus died for us. We are the elect. We are righteous. Just because we trip up on our walk of holiness, we don't beat ourselves up. We hear God saying, it's okay. Keep going. And I was on a day celebrating the life of Simon Burrington Ward, who was a great leader of CMS, Bishop of Coventry. And one of the things he often said was, isn't the word confession a lovely warm word? It's where I know I'm loved. It really surprised me, because I'd been brought up to associate confession with guilt. And he said, no, if you're beloved, if you're amongst the redeemed, confession is just saying, Daddy, that didn't work. And he says, okay. I mean, sometimes it's a big thing, but it's still our Father saying it's okay. So a kind of confession from in Psalm 81. The Israelites were brought out of Egypt and they couldn't quite believe it. And Lord, we have left our Egypt and are in the promised land, and sometimes we don't quite believe it. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. And the Israelites, as they were walking towards the promised land, as we walk towards eternity, they were walking towards the land of milk and honey, and we have the milk and honey. Because they didn't understand, and because they forgot, they began to operate in their own strength and made themselves the center. And sometimes we do that. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Oh, that my people would listen to me. And then the rock where they live would become the place where they found honey. And sometimes our hearts can be like a rock and Jesus just can't break in. And sometimes our memories are like a rock and we can't get past them. And circumstances, we're all human beings, we know what I mean. And we need the sweetness of Jesus to pour out of who we are. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. And today's a good day for you because you're going to get a second absolution. How often do you receive that good gift? Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in life eternal. I always think that should be, and keeps you in life eternal, because he does. Amen. Actually, is that a piano that I see over there? What I'd like to do is go back to Jesus, be the center. But we're not going to sing it. So we're going to sit quietly and read it. What, tell me your name. Sarah. While Sarah plays for us. And resist belting out the chorus. Be quiet. Just enjoy the Spirit speaking. Thank you, Sarah. Thank you. So let's sing the chorus twice and then the last couplet. Just as we're seated. Here's a stone with honey. You may like to walk past. Do you have a routine for here? Well, just come and go back. You can sort yourselves out tardily, can't you? So the invitation is to come and touch the rock, who is Jesus. Or is the rock which rolls away, so that the light may shine from the tomb, the light of resurrection. And you may like to touch the honey and lick and say, bless you, Lord, for your sweetness. Oh, Lord, come afresh in sweetness. Should we just be quiet as we do that? So we just hear the rustle of our clothes and the rustle of our breathing. I often go to a monastery on retreats and I've learned to go into silence, and it's a very comfortable place. So if you'd like, just make a big crocodile and come and touch the stone or the honey. Thank you, Lord. I love that two of you, who I will not point out, thought, ooh, there's a pool of honey on the tray. It's a kind of more, Lord, isn't it? Let's be quiet. How sweet the name of Jesus sounds in a believer's ear. It calms his sorrow, heals his wounds, takes away her fear. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. That's the quietest hallelujah I've ever heard. Hallelujah. No, that's not African enough. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now you've got the word. Now let's get the gesture, okay? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Well, I'll excuse the six of you who just couldn't go there. Unless you want to have a last go. You ready? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, that's it. Oh, thank you for your hospitality. How should we end the last song and then your blessing? So, are we following a piece of paper or the screens? Which? Both. 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 So, thank you.
Seated before we finish our service. The reason why these lovely people were late because we were praying with people, and we don't want Marilyn people to miss out on that opportunity to be prayed with. You know, just as we were worshiping there, I remembered a particular day, and I'm not going to tell you where this happened because that would be really bad if I told you where it happened. But I can remember a particular day. I was bringing a wee nephew home, and he lived in a kind of cul-de-sac thing, and an ice cream van came in ahead of me. And this particular area, you'll know now why I'm not telling you where it was. Suddenly the ice cream van came and all of these people in dressing gowns. It was about 3 o'clock in the day, but all these people in dressing gowns and jammies and all this sort of stuff came out, and there was a queue of people in their jammies to get ice cream. I thought, shocking really, they're in their jammies at this time. But the thing that just struck me is, they wanted the ice cream enough, okay, for in two ways. That they couldn't even be bothered getting dressed in case they would be at the back of the queue, and also that they were willing to queue for it. What a thing, that they were willing to queue for the ice cream. And I'm sure all of you, in fact, I know from the picnics across the road, are willing to queue for ice cream as well. And the lovely thing was, there was just a queue this morning to be prayed with. The lovely thing is, John Newton, we'll think about this tonight, but John Newton, he wrote two songs, many more, but two particular songs that strike me. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound. How sweet the sound. It's a really sweet thing, the grace of the Lord Jesus. It's a really, there's honey flowing out of that empty tomb. And also, how sweet the name of Jesus sounds in a believer's ear. It's really sweet because it makes all the difference. And the lovely thing was, when we went round the doors, so we knocked 570 doors yesterday, we think. We maybe didn't get 570 people in, but I would say 70% of people, when we knocked their doors, wanted prayer. They wanted the sweetness of God into their lives. And there's a wee prayer list, and I think Giles, wherever he is, was worked quite hard because the prayer points kept on coming in, and it was wonderful to read the WhatsApp of all these prayer points. And we pray that that's made a difference today. So what we'll have now, just now as we finish our service, is listen, the ice cream's better than spuds. Now, I know you have spuds waiting at home, but ice cream's better than spuds, and honey is better than most other things. So we'll just take just a few moments, and our team are going to be here. If they'll just be here in twos up at the front here, and maybe Sarah would just gently play. And if you want to just come forward for a little blessing, or you want to come forward with something in your life that's bitter and you would love the sweetness of Jesus, then let's just come forward on this special day of this special weekend. So let's just be really bold. And these guys, maybe you take your places up here, and Giles and Emma and Cosman will maybe just take their places as well, just to pray. And let's just be really bold. We're not going to come forward in our dressing gowns, but let's do come forward for something really sweet and really, really beautiful. So let's just come forward, whatever our needs might be, and let's not hold back or be shy from that. He's really good. And whatever in our life is bitter or difficult, he really just wants to put his sweetness into it. So let's approach the throne of the one who deals in amazing grace and amazing sweetness. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Come forward for a blessing. Come forward with a need. Whatever you have to bring to God for sweetness, just come.